Hey everyone, Joey Santos here, just your online pastor here at Christ Church, and I'm here with Jackie. Maybe you know her, you don't know her. Usually she's there in that cage. What do we call that?
Drum tank.
Drum tank. Wow.
Never knew.
You have an AC in there, like it's like it's pretty
so
cool.
So there's a very small fan. I turned this little light switch on, it goes like it's real, it doesn't do much. But
get pretty warm
it's
in
hot.
There, doesn't it? Well, Jackie, that's the thing, Jackie. You people, they know you as the drummer, but there's so much more to Jackie than just playing drums. Is that right?
Well, I guess we're about to find out.
We're about to find out. So we're going to find out. We're going to get to know Jackie today. We're very excited. She's being, you've been with in our team now for how long?
I was trying to think of that on the way here. I think that I started playing with you all at the end of 2017, beginning of 2018.
Wow.
So it's been
a year and a half.
2 years, I think.
2 years.
If we do the math right.
Yeah.
But I think so. But the funny thing is, when I went to Cincinnati Christian University, my first time ever at Christ Church was in 2002.
Oh.
Yeah, so we're taking it back a little bit.
Yeah.
I used to be in this thing called Solid Rock. It was when we were in high school, you could audition for this band.
I'm sure some people, you just brought back some memories on people's minds right now.
Solid Rock, yep. So that's my first time ever stepping foot in Christ Church. And I played guitar. And I remember we played, like, I think two of the songs we did last Sunday. Well,
yeah.
Two of the songs we've done before,
yeah.
You know. We played them then, so they're still...
Now, tell me a little bit. Let's go back a little bit. So, tell me about growing up. So, did you grow up in a Christian home? I mean, I think it's interesting. Like, for some people, Christian home means so many different things.
Yeah, so yes and no. So, my parents and my family are all Christian. We didn't go to church necessarily. We were the Christmas and Easter Christians, C&E, you know. So, went in Christmas, went on Easter. I remember one Easter we went, I think I was in third grade. My brother decided he wanted to get baptized. And we literally, because he did, I thought, well, I should too. So I started diving into what that really meant. And I was baptized, I think it was a Easter Sunday, gosh, couldn't tell you the year, 1994 maybe. I remember specifically my brother got bitten by a snapping turtle when he was baptized. So that was traumatic for him. But we were just in a creek across the street from the church, and we had this big gathering. So we grew up in a Christian household, but we didn't necessarily go to church until when I was in high school, there was this cute boy that went to a church that my grandparents went to, and they were like, would you like to come with us? And I said, yes, I would. So ended up going there, ended up dating the guy, ended up being real close to this family, and that's when I actually gave my life to Christ.
Tell us a little bit about that experience, like that moment of, you know, starting out of a relationship with a boy, but then discover something extra.
Yeah.
How was that?
Well, I think that I knew from influence growing up with my family, it all made sense because all of the values were the same, except for I got to understand what a relationship with Christ really meant. I remember I was on a boating trip with a bunch of my friends, and my brother let me borrow his Jars of Clay CD. Remember them?
Oh.
The song Flood, you know. And so I took that CD with me. CD's really dating myself. Took the CD with me, my Walkman. And I remember popping it in on the way back from this trip. We went to Lake Cumberland and we came back. And the song Love Song for a Savior came on. And I don't know why, I just started crying in the back with all my friends are just like, you know, having fun.
Yeah.
And here I am like, I gave my life to Christ and I knew it. It was strange. It was just like, all of a sudden, I'm sure you can remember when you became a Christian, how it's really hard to explain the spiritual side of it, but I felt it. I knew it was there. I heard
it's
voice.
Real.
It's real. And it never was tangible until that point in my life. Now, dating somebody, going to church and finding that too, just made it better. You know, it started to make me realize that the relationships that I want in my life doesn't mean they aren't Christian, but it means that, especially like in a dating environment, absolutely. Like, it makes everything cohesive, strong, same mindset. And I feel like that I grew a ton just having that. Yeah.
So now, tell us about at what point growing up, music started to become part of your life?
I almost didn't go that route. So it was either music or basketball.
Wow.
I'm glad I didn't choose basketball. You don't want to see me play now. But I remember in third grade, my choir director, like my music teacher, was like, you need to be in the select choir. I was like, that sounds cool. Sure, with a bunch of friends. And so we went and did that. Fifth grade came along. That's when you could choose if you want to be in band. So I was like, Mom, I want to be in band. She goes, what instrument do you want to play? I said, drums. And she said, no. She said, that's a boy's instrument. And I was like, oh, okay, what about trumpet? She goes, no, that's still a boy's instrument. It's like, what can I play? She said, clarinet. And I later found out, just because she played clarinet growing up, so there could be like a little relationship there. Glad I did it. Music just kind of started growing with me. Now, sixth grade was the deciding factor. It was basketball or band. And I was like, all the cool kids are in band. I'm not going to be in band. So I was like, I'm quitting. And Mom's like, no, you're not. You sure? Because if you do that, you can't go back. Like, you decide this. You commit to this. I'm glad that I had that, like, solid, you know, parentship there. I chose music. And I went for it. And I even tried to go back to basketball, and it was not the same. But music has been kind of ingrained in my life since I was a kid. I sang in the car with my mom. She would always sing in the car. So I was like, that must be a thing we're supposed to do in the car. She'd listen to Bob Seger and Rod Stewart all the time. So, which I do now, which is funny. But music's been kind of like a part of my life. And I realized that I could put the two together as a Christian and a musician when I started going to church.
Now, what we'll talk about, like, tell us a little bit about that. Like, you, because I think people watching, they may think, you know, they hear you say music, you know, Christian, but we're not talking about the traditional way of people may think music and Christian comes together.
Yeah.
Right?
Yeah.
So, and because something probably hits you, like, I want to make this joyful sound. It's going to sound a little different.
Yeah.
Do you know what I mean? I'm going to write some different things. Tell us a little bit about how you discovered, like, I know this might sound, like, weird, but your sound.
Yeah, sure. So when I joined that church, there was my boyfriend's grandma at the time. She was, like, a great musician, and she saw a bunch of teenagers that could play music together. Why don't we start a church band? And I was like, what? I could play music in church? And we were called PS150.
Oh, wow.
Yeah, got it down. We had a drummer, I played guitar. We had a bass player, piano player. We had a cowbell player. I'm not kidding.
You gotta have cowbell.
Had to have cowbell. We actually, that's another story for another day. But I started understanding the words to the songs as soon as because I'd never gotten to play guitar in a band before. I always played at my house. The first song I learned was Lenny Kravitz, Fly. And then I go to church and I'm like, I know these chords. I've been practicing this for a year. I can hang with them. So we started this, and I started reading the words, and we started having worship experiences and practices. You know, it wasn't necessary. We went and did, like, little tours. We're from Georgetown, Ohio, so we didn't have very many options of places to play. We played at this place called JC's Place in Mount Orb. I don't know if anybody remembers JC's Place. We played there, packed the house. And we played at various churches, and so we started doing the church tour kind of thing. And I started, like, really grasping the words more than the music. And it started breathing into me, you know? So I knew that that's kind of the avenue I wanted to take professionally, for especially when I was a junior and senior in high school. It's like, I want to do music, but I also want to grow my relationship with God, and I also feel a calling. Like, I didn't even know what that word meant. So I sat down with my worship leader, Scott Hennig, and I said, hey, I don't know what this looks like for me. So I was going to go to a different college. Sorry, I'm just jumping all around. I'm just telling you my whole life story. Let's go. But I was going to go to Asbury College in Lexington. Had my roommate picked out. Had my major picked out. I was going to go to music ed. Then I did solid rock. And that's full circle kind of thing. The last stop we had was here at Christ Church. And I remember being there just feeling, this is what I want to do. And I remember being on that tour bus with them. And I said, is it too late for me to, like, go to your school instead of Asbury? And they said, never.
Of course.
They said, you can absolutely come to our school. So I called my mom on the trip, and I said, can we switch? Like, I feel bad because I know we spent a year and a half figuring this out, but I feel God's telling me to do this. And so that's when I decided to go into worship ministry.
My soul. Who can split the world around and hold me ever close? Who can search the depths of me and love me to the core? Controls the world I see and walks me through it all. No one but you. No.
To Cincinnati Christian, it was Cincinnati Bible College at the time.
Yes.
And I was there for 1 year until they changed their name to Cincinnati Christian University. But that whole year, that whole summer, just helped me, like, help breathe life into me. And a lot of the peers that I played with also went to that school, too. So we ended up having a deep friendship in high school before college.
On college years, did that help you to kind of help form that the direction better?
Absolutely.
See the direction on where you want to go? Because, again, I think there's some things that you probably discovered through the college journey.
Yeah.
That tell us a little bit about that.
One of my favorite classes I ever had was with my professor, Dr. Gregory. And he taught a class on basically understanding worship music and what its intentionality is. So we would dive into old hymns and read through it and go, he would always say, now what's the story? We'd always like, oh, he's wanting to talk about the story again. But now I'm 34 and I'm asking myself the same question every time. Like, what's the story that this song is trying to share? What's the story that the lyricist is trying to share? What's the story the people in the Bible who are writing the books are trying to share? It all started making sense. Like, it's all collective.
Yeah.
And so the lyrics to the music also work with the Bible most of the time. And so he would always challenge us, what's the story? What's the story? And then we would have like tangible worship experiences during class. We'd be in class and he'd say, all right, Jackie, you go play piano and we're all just gonna sing. And I want you guys to think through how God's working in your life and just share that. So it's kind of like, what do you call that? Charismatic worship. So we did that a lot, and I started growing in that, realizing that it's not just a word on a sheet of paper. It's a word that's breathing life into others.
Yes.
And music just helps lift that. And so I knew that music was powerful, but I didn't know how to put the two together necessarily until I took that class.
So let me pause that,
yeah.
Pause your story for a second. And tell us a little bit about, in your experience, through this journey, what does worship mean to you?
It's a loaded question. It means a lot. It means, for me personally, me being able to worship is my personal devotion to God. So, you listening to me sing, if that encourages you, that encourages me, but it's really me and God. But I want to be able to share that with others. So it's personal and it's congregational. I know it's like a huge church word, but it's like, it's no, both.
It's that there's a connection there, right?
Yeah, absolutely.
I mean, in your way, experience that from the stage.
Every
worship.
Every Sunday I still do. And I'm not even up front. I'm drumming.
Right, you're incredible at it. Not just saying this. We have footage to prove that. Because you're leading worship inside that drum cage or that tank. And you're leading from it. And that's one thing we talk about all the time. It's, you know, people are not, it's not just that one person in the front hold the microphone, lead worship. Everybody on the stage leads worship. The band, the singers, even the people behind the scenes, they have the influence in leading worship through what they do.
Yeah.
And I think that's so important that you mentioned that because, again, we have footage to prove that you actually lead the worship from playing drums. Like, and I think people understand that. But that's something that we share. It's not something that we just take to ourselves, but worship's something we share.
Well, it's two very simple words. Worship, which means worshiping a being, which that's our God. And a leader is somebody who can exemplify that, so you don't have to be somebody sharing all the words. Your actions speak loud, too.
Now, tell us about getting out of college. How we got to that point.
Oh.
Getting out of college, life gets real.
Life gets real. So, my very first day after graduation, I started a full-time job as a youth minister at River Hills Christian Church. I was a worship leader with the youth ministry that I transitioned to with a youth pastor named Adam Norsworthy, and he developed me in ways that I am so thankful for. He helped me understand flow of a service, planning the whole nine yards, and so I felt prepared when I went in, and then when I went in, I was absolutely not. So you go to school and you learn this stuff, but when you actually sit and do it, It's totally different. I came into a group that grew from like 4 kids, I'm not kidding you, to 150. And then they all left when he left. Natural. So here I was, wanting to help keep this alive. They were all mad at me because their youth pastor was gone. And I was like, I still love you. Let's have some fun. Eventually, they warmed up to it. And I developed teams. I was a worship leader, so I had junior high and high school ministry doing that with me. And still some of those students that I worked with, some of them are worship leaders today, which is really cool. But that was a tough season because working in ministry, especially right out of college, it's 24/7, and I had a real hard time with boundaries. So I had to, like, my bosses were like, take Mondays off, disconnect, turn your phone off, make sure that you have a day of rest. And I couldn't. I was like, I'm gonna go Kings Island, you know? So, but it was tough because, one, it was awesome, and it was okay for it to be tough because it made me grow, and I saw these students really grasping things that we were doing. It was really hard leaving that church. It was really difficult. Do you mind if I share that with you?
No, go ahead.
So, I think it was like 2010, I had a volunteer who was drumming for us who unfortunately committed suicide on Christmas. And it was an accidental suicide. It was an overdose. And so, I got a phone call from some of the students. They were saying, we just talked to him last night. He's dead. I was with my family. So I said, I gotta go. Students they need somebody and they don't know how to process this. And I was supposed to lead worship for the church the next day. It ended up being a big ordeal where I couldn't do both. And they eventually asked me, because of that situation, they said, you know, we're gonna have to move forward without you. You know, we realized that they told me some things that really hurt me. And it took a really long time for me to heal. They told me I wasn't gifted in youth ministry. They told me I wasn't gifted in ministry. And I was just like, that's okay, you don't have to punch a girl while she's down, you know, like, I'll just move away peacefully, and I'll start a new career. So, I left that church, and then I started working in retail, but then I started reaching out with different churches, and so it was almost like it was time. It was time to move on, it was time to do some different things. So I worked with, I drummed with Montgomery Community Church for a few years. I actually just ran into the pastor on the bike trail the other day. And I worked with Crossroads and Oakley and on the west side for a little bit. And then I think it was you all. I think then it was Christchurch. And it was really that gap. I took a break. I took a break from church.
Let's just take another pause there and talk a little bit about that reality. Because I think it's good for people to understand that when we work in a ministry, there's a dosage of reality that people think we don't know. And that's okay. You know, we are inside the daily grind of ministry. We see it, we experience, we know it. And the thing about ministry, and you know what I'm talking about, it's interesting to me because it is the it's not a product, but you know what I mean. Like the very essential part of ministry's people. Like we're not working a factory with some little parts and assembling something.
Yeah.
People is all of it. And when people are just part of everything we do, it's hard to separate. It's hard to just walk away. It's hard to just find out something else to do. And I think for you, if you don't mind, explain to us so people, help people to understand, how deep is that pain of that separation?
It's still real today. That happened in 2010. It's 10 years ago. You know, it's still hard for me to trust working for church, not for you all, but you know, church, you know, it's difficult. It brings back hard feelings because I never got an apology. And that was tough for me to accept, just going like, you know what? I don't have to find joy in somebody apologizing to me. I can find that myself, and I can find that with God. I was mad for a while, you know? I didn't know how to process it. I gave my entire life to that ministry, you know? And It hurt. And going into a different field was weird. Because that's all I knew. You know, I'd never worked. I worked in ministry, and then here I am working in the real world. That's, a lot of people say that when they leave ministry and go into a different environment. And it's very different. But I will say, through that hurt, I used it as fuel to make myself stronger and more independent. And I would say the relationships I developed outside of, like, I wouldn't know half the people I work with today if it weren't for that situation. So sure, through the hurt there was growth, and that's fine, but it still hurt.
Absolutely.
Bring new wine.
Now, there's something new that came out of, brand new came out of this experience, right? Through months and weeks and months and probably years after that. And you start developing your own material, your own music, your all the way out to your own band.
Yeah.
Tell us about it.
So I met the musicians when I worked at Guitar Center, and I started collaborating with a guy named Stephen Yokley, and it was 2014. We wrote a tune together, we recorded it together. And I said, "This is good. What are we doing?" And he goes, "I don't know, what are we doing?" I said, "Let's come up with a name." So we were like, what could it be? What's something that sounds cool? We're in the Queen City, so I want to be Cincinnati based. I thought, Mad Queen sounds cool. Mad Queen, Mad Queen, Mad Queen. One word, of course, because it's just, it looks more strong. And it was developed in 2014, and then I did nothing with it for like 3 years. I moved to Cleveland, and I was in a band called Tevis. And some of the material that I wrote with that ended up coming with me. So I remember I was in Cleveland in the garage that I was renting a house, and we had a garage that turned into a studio. I just got my microphone, my guitar, my amp, my drum set, my computer, everything. I was like, let's write some songs. Let's just do this. And that's where all my songs came from. It was a garage in Cleveland in 2017. So then I moved back to Cincinnati. I joined a few other bands to kind of get myself warmed back up into it, and then realized, let's just do this. Let's stop being afraid. And I think that was the hard part for me, because I'm used to helping others with their sound. I'm not used to doing it myself. So I was really scared, and I released my first song. I think that's the first song you and Trevor ever heard that I did too. It was released on my birthday in 2018.
Yeah.
It's called Wrong Girl, and it's just me like singing in front of a mirror. Whatever, people liked the song.
Yeah.
I got a band to play with me. We played live. I changed the band a few times just because I was crafting my sound as I was going. And through all that hard work, in a year, we won a Cincinnati Entertainment Award.
Really?
Yeah. Best New Artist of Cincinnati.
1 year.
1 year. Yep. So I got some work to do.
Wow, that's so good.
Yeah. So it was a great experience. We ended up, Cincinnati hosts it at Memorial Hall. And then they have an after party afterward. And they asked us, and they had to have known we were going to win, because that's not fair. We played with another group that didn't win.
Got it.
And we played at Lucius Q. I don't know if you've been there, but if you need to go down to Cincinnati sometime, grab their barbecue. It's so good. But we played an after show there, and like all of Cincinnati's good top musicians who've come through, they were all there. And I was like, this is an amazing experience.
Wow.
Just locally, it's a great experience. And there's like, I'm just surrounded by so much talent, you know? Like, it's not me. The thing is, like, that couldn't have happened without people I collaborate with. Because I'd rather do it with people than by myself.
Yeah.
So, I would say things are going well. You know, even in the midst of quarantine, I did a bunch of live streams through Cincy Music.
Mm-hmm.
And it got exhausting for a little bit, so I had to take a little breather for the summer so I can ride my bike.
Yeah.
But it helped me join other bands and develop great relationships with other artists too. So,
tell us, looking ahead, what do you see?
I'm going to give you a real answer here. Don't know. And I'm okay with that. I've been one of those people that I do what's in front of me. I try to plan and it never works. So I've just started to just go, you know what? I'm going to do what's in front of me and I'm going to make it happen. Maybe it's organic that way. Maybe God's directing me in a specific way because of that. And even in the midst of like rock and roll music, I'm still making sure that he's the center of it. You know, like in my conversations and in my interactions with people. I want to help connect to people. So I don't know what's next. And I'm okay with that. Let's go. I can't predict anything because, you know, with 2020,
it's out.
Juggled. I don't know. So I am going the path that seems like it's the right one to go. So I know that I'm about to record an album for Mad Queen, but that was interrupted from COVID. So we'll figure that out when this kind of quiets down a little bit. But that's the next step, is to release an album. And it's fun. It's a lot of work.
That's good. So, yeah. Thanks for sharing your story.
Oh, thanks for letting me share my story.
Appreciate that.
I trust you, I don't need. vessel. Make me an offering. Make me whatever you want me to be. I came here with nothing, and all you have given me, Jesus.